Okay, so I know in the demands of nutrition, we all need to know. Let's talk about the carrot tops. Now, interestingly, they grow and they grow and they're sprouting out from the carrot. And often they're cut and thrown away. We don't use them in soups or anything. But the more and more we're finding out about these little darlings is that not only you can leave them in the garden, you can leave your carrots in the garden, you can cut the tops and they regrow. That's a wonderful, that right there, that makes it like an everlasting, you know, it just keeps going like a fountain. And yet, you get to take off of it, you know, you get to take food from it. So it's really wonderful. So now the properties and what it does, very good for, I'll show you the list, kidney, very good for your bladder, very good for your heart, very good with magnesium content, that dispersion. Also, when it goes with assimilation, it's very good for cleansing out your internal system. So it's a good cleanser. Now, I missed something else. It's major osteoporosis. A major osteoporosis fighter. So all of this, you know, hunching over where you stay and you can't get up again. It's gonna make, maybe it's from the carrots themselves, you know, they're it's being fed from those tops, you know, back into the carrot, and they grow so strong and tall. Well, osteoporosis fighter. Another thing is the Greeks used to use carrot tops specifically to fight tumors. So that's pretty neat. You can have them raw, you can have them in soups, of course. But if you go with raw, you can juice them, you can have them in salad. Now, if you put them in the juicer, I recommend you have to run one other thing with it, like an apple, a slice of apple, because it just doesn't seem to want to really juice just the green on its own. I hate adding apples though to everything. That's not really the point. I really want it just green, but in a lot of these juicers, they won't give you just green. But as a salad itself maker, it's awesome. So very good for you are these carrot tops. And I was watching a woman just yesterday, or 2 days ago. An incredible body, really, really, just incredible muscle tone, and all of that, you know. And then she's grabbing her carrot tops. She was in a hurry, but at that point she didn't really say what it was so great for, just that they were excellent for you. And so I did a little more research to find out just why. They're not yelling that they're good for your eyesight, which, you know, one would think. They're not yelling that, but they are very, very, we're talking the kidney, we're talking the bladder, we're talking cleaning out your intestinal tract, we're talking about, washing away impurities that are in your body. So it's very, very good for getting detoxifying, you know, a detox process. And very rightly so, you know, if the Greeks were already knowing about this a long time ago and saying that's what we use for tumors, well, there's probably not a wrong going on there. It's probably right. No reason why not. Now, was that it? Was that all I had about the carrot tops? It's just they're really neat to grow. Because I my whole life I've avoided growing carrots. And now I find out that, gosh dang it, they're kind of neat in the garden. They're beautiful, actually. I was always worried about thinning them out, you know, because they tend to be the tiniest seeds. And then problem because you have to thin them out, but it's not really at all. Now I'm finding out more and more from these little darlings that you can use the tops, and really, really, also for bad breath. They were given for bad breath, cleanses this whole region in here. So like a mouthwash, you can use it as a parsley, as a parsley substitute, and also a neat recipe for it is the pesto. You can make carrot top pesto, and that's nice because normally pesto is requiring like the persil or a basil, and those can be pretty pricey. So as a pesto. Main ingredient, that's pretty neat. Anyway, what else do I have? Well, I don't know. I shouldn't mix videos, I know it. But I wanted to talk about the balancing stone. The balancing stones that we see all over. You go hiking and you see three stones, and they're the larger stone, the middle stone, and another one. Sometimes people will stack them even taller, but usually it's just three stones. And then I'm like, well, okay, that's neat, but what about meditation with those stones? You know, let's take it a little further and bring it into the meditation, you know, because sometimes we're lazy meditators, and we kind of need something like a mind's eye, to habit with, so to live with while you're meditating. So I'm sitting here going, well, that's it, you know. So, and it was funny too because I wasn't thinking about the three stones before my meditation. That happened after, but yet I grabbed three stones for my meditation. So it came through as the answer to further meditation, to a further extravagance, because meditation is really, you know, your imagination getting more and more extravagant and more linky. It likes to link, you know, communicate. Okay, so here I took two plain stones, just like frosted glass, actually. And I'm like, well, how boring, really, frosted glass. But I'll try it. So I put those in my palms. See, and the reason it doesn't have to be frosted glass. It can be stones, any kind of stones. But with the weight of something, when you have the weight of and these are almost parallel objects, so they make it easier for the brain to run the data into your palm. It's because you're trying to get the chi energy, that chi energy directional. So you get that chi and you really feel that you're holding on to something. You really feel like it's becoming energized. Okay. And so then over here, and then you have the other palm and you do the same exact thing. So now you're holding on to two things. You can, of course, be in your meditation, your guru poses. Now you're holding on to these two, and then you try to do things with them, of course. You try to play games. You make rainbows. You take one stone, and if you want, you can whisk all the energy of it all the way around you, and then bring it into the other stone. You can run that stone all throughout your body, through your head, all the way through, down to your toes, back up again, down to the other side of your body, and then out to this stone. So you can play kissy-kissy that way. The easiest, though, for most people is you take one stone energy and you just try to make a small rainbow back and forth, one stone to another. And so you end up kind of like holding on to that arc formation. And it's chi. This is you're tapping into your own Tai Chi, your own chi energy. Your and it's your body. It's your chakras that are delivering this. That are becoming more and more balanced. Each time you do this, you balance your chakras. Okay. Okay, so now I'm like, okay, well, I did that, and I was like, well, I want another stone. Okay, so I just got a regular other stone. And then I was silly, of course, and I put it on my foot. I just balance it on my foot somewhere. I'm like on my ankle, not right on like that part. So I balance the stone on my ankle while I'm going on with these. And so now I've got three stones. And so now you play directionals with those, where you make kind of like geometry. You know how in geometry you can make an acute angle, you can make an obtuse angle, right angles, all of that. So now you're aware, your mind is aware of the stone that's on your foot, the stone that's in your hand, in your right hand, and the stone that's in your left hand. And then you link them together. You actually draw in your mind, you draw that energy path, and then from the one stone all the way down to the one in your ankle. And then you can make a triangle if you want, but it's not necessary. You can just make the greater than or the less than sign. But if you send the energy, it's about sending that energy. And you can send the energy slow, or you can send the energy fast. That's up to you. So it's a train, it's a brain entrainment chakra chi. Now all of this is going on, and at the end of it I'm like, well, okay, well, this is neat to add all these extra stones. I've seen lots of people, you know, they lie down and they have like stones all over their chests and on their foreheads and on their backs or whatever, and that's really neat. But then I'm like, gotta go one step further, and it popped into my head, you know, out on a hiking walk, or, you know, where I saw, you know, those three stones, and I just a place. It can be any of the places where you were, where you saw the three stones. And so you link, you still hold the energy. The key is you have to hold the energy for the stones that you have, and then you send a link to that, those three stones. So you end up with, we call that, when it goes that distance, my stones were way over in Corsica. So when it goes that distance, it becomes really exciting. It becomes an exciting chi moment, and you just try to maintain that for a while. And so in a way, you become a balancer. You become an earth world balancer. So you're balancing those stones. You're balancing your stones, and you're creating a giant energy from you all the way there. So, and it doesn't, it's not even that far. It doesn't feel like it's that far to go. But it is. It is actually, you know, when you get on airplanes, but in your meditation mind, it's very fast. It's very easy to get there. So anyway, so that was my fun. Put them on your shoulders too if you've got chi up there. You do all kinds of things. But, Tantriya. So, enjoy that one. I know people need, what do we call it? We call them, meditation stones, some type of something like that. Yeah. Anyway, I'll try to come up with something clever. And carrot tops.